Okay, here's the story. Only a fifth of 17 million Brits, 17-odd million Brits, 17.3 actually is the figure. Why does that figure ring a bell? 17.3 million. Oh, I did say it was a Brexit-free zone. Ain't that a coincidence? Within 100,000. Anyway, only a fifth of 17.3 million Britons who suffer with back pain will ever recover, a study has shown. A study finding that only 20% of back pain sufferers see symptoms go. So let's talk about living with chronic pain. Back pain, I guess, in particular. But let's not rule out other forms of physical ailments and the pain that they do indeed cause. 08081 009956. I cannot do it without you. Andy Murray, who is retiring because of hip issues, who's only 31 years of age. And don't automatically assume that a hip replacement is associated solely with older people. A pal of mine had a hip replaced when he was, how old was Cooksey? 48, something like that. 48. And I think his other side is going as well. So he's going to have a double hip replacement. And the pain, I can tell you the pain, every now and again, it'll just seize up. Oh, it just seize up and start limping. And oh, boy, I have to sit down and maybe a bit of heat helps. Mike Grice is an osteopath at Movement Therapy Clinic in the city of Birmingham. Mike, hi, good morning.
Hi, Danny, how are you?
Yeah, I'm fine, thanks. I have experienced, Mike, over the years. I have experienced lower back pain. And I think my lanky status in the household doesn't help, because sometimes I'm having to. My mum and dad might used to, well, they still do, but I used to live with them in this very low ceiling cottage with Tudor beams everywhere and everything. And I was forever having to sort of bend my neck just to walk around the house. And I don't know whether that's a tributary factor, Mike, but lower back pain is very common.
It is very common, yes. It's something we see in the clinic every day on a daily basis. And it's interesting the report that came out in the Daily Mail today.
Yes, and is this something that you would reflect as being accurate, the fact that it's a very poor or a very low success rate at curing people, 1 in 5?
It's interesting actually, because I got a link to the actual paper, the Daily Mail didn't report what the actual summary of the findings from the researcher, and she actually said that those people, those 20% who didn't recover, they would benefit from a more of an individualized program to recover rather than a cookie cutter kind of one size fits all approach, which is something that we do at the clinic as well. We see that some exercises, some treatments may work for some people, but for others they may not be beneficial. So it's working with that person to find the best approach for them.
Now, just to use Andy Murray as an example about how younger people have hips that end up being painful. Now, he would have access to some of the best physicians and osteopaths, and you name it, that guy has got access to them all. So that would illustrate, what would that say to you, Mike? Is that the fact that top flight tennis is just so powerful that even the slightest detraction from your ability to move means there's no point playing? Or would that suggest to you that even with all of the access to all of the great osteopaths, physiotherapists, whatever, that, you know, there are some conditions that can't be eased?
It's really interesting with Andy, actually. It's something that we've been discussing since the news broke last week. And see, pain is a very, very complicated thing. So and it's very poorly correlated to damage to tissue. So the fact that Andy has had some hip issues in the past may be a contributory factor, but there's lots of other factors as well. Because obviously playing tennis means a hell of a lot to Andy, and the fact that he can't play at the level that he wants to play will have a significant impact on his levels of pain.
Yeah, that's so interesting, actually. It just illustrates, doesn't it, about, you know, professional tennis and the fine line between being a tournament winner and being an also-ran. And he just doesn't, I guess, want to be an also-ran.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, just go back to the, rather than the supersonic human elements of top flight sports, Mike, what's your advice to people who maybe have been living with pain and they're on a constant prescription from their doctors, just managing it, not actually solving the cause, but just managing, taking the edge.
Yeah, I think, again, it's that individualised approach. So that if someone has persistent pain and they've been trying to manage it through pharmacological pathways and that's really not working for them, then it's useful to explore other options. And it's not always going to the gym and, you know, getting strong. It can be just things like going for a walk. And if you've been off for work for a long period of time because of back pain, actually just getting back into work and getting into those habits helps with the pain levels and then helps you come off of the medication, sort of returning back to a normal life again.
You got it. Listen, it's great to talk to you. Thank you so much for your time, Mike.
You're
really
welcome.
Appreciate it. Good man. Osteopath there at Movement Therapy Clinic in Birmingham, Mike Grice. Let's get some callers, please. Thanks, Mike.